The head of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or NATO, believes the world's armies must cut their huge carbon footprints to keep pace with global efforts to tackle climate change. Little reliable data exists on emissions created by military activities, but a 2019 report concluded that the U.S. military would be the world's 47th largest emitter of greenhouse gases if it were a country. NATO's Secretary General says the alliance has started to work on a methodology to measure the emissions of armed forces. He hopes this will be completed by next year.
Green military or a strong military. We need a green and strong military and defense forces. But I believe that that's absolutely possible to reconcile the need for both climate-friendly and strong and effective armed forces. So there's an energy revolution taking place out there in the civilian society that will impact the military. And this is about keeping up the pace, being part of that transformation. And that will be an advantage not only for the climate, but also for our military capabilities.
Stoltenberg began pushing the alliance to become greener some time ago, but NATO diplomats say his efforts were hampered by former U.S. President Donald Trump.
Indonesia could phase out low coal-fired power plants much earlier with sufficient financial help from the international community. The Southeast Asian country previously said it planned to retire coal for electricity by 2056, as part of its plan to reach net zero carbon emissions by 2060. Now, Indonesia's finance minister believes the phase out can be moved up to 2040, but that the country cannot do it alone. Indonesia is the world's eighth biggest greenhouse gas emitter, with coal accounting for around 65% of its energy mix. It's also the world's biggest coal exporter. Indonesia promises to go into technical details on how it can move up its climate targets on Wednesday. Amazon founder Jeff Bezos announces a $2 billion pledge to support nature restoration. The Bezos Earth Fund plans to participate in restoring lands in Africa. The billionaire also said Amazon aims to reach net zero carbon emissions by 2040, power all of its operations and renewable energy by 2025, and convert its delivery fleet to electric vehicles. Bezos is one of the world's richest men, with a net worth of more than $191 billion.
In this critical year, and what we all know is the decisive decade, we must all stand together to protect our world. Ahead of COP27 next year, the Bezos Earth Fund would be eager to participate in a concerted strategy led by African nations to seriously and effectively ramp up support for restoration on the continent. However, we cannot rely only on governments, NGOs, and philanthropies to solve the climate crisis. The private sector must also play its part to reduce carbon emissions. Companies need to take leadership positions.
An indigenous group from the Brazilian Amazon says deforestation plans hatched at the UN Climate Conference in Glasgow would only succeed if funds were directed to the forest's custodians. More than 100 national leaders on Monday pledged $19 billion to halt and reverse deforestation by the end of the decade. But the indigenous women of the Brazilian Amazon Union doubt it will progress unless the funding is made available to the actual people who care for the land. The WWF welcomes the COP26 announcement, but also says the policies and funds need to be implemented urgently and with local engagement.
So, you know, we've been here before. There have been other declarations to halt and deforestation. This, I think, is probably the most comprehensive and diverse set of leaders. Also encouraging to see the private sector also supporting this. But, you know, we really need to see, action and urgent action. So we need to see these words translated into binding policies and commitments. And also, you know, a full and effective engagement with those on the front lines of deforestation, such as indigenous peoples and local communities.
In business, Sudena Corporation asserts the legality of its acquisition of shares in the Malampaya gas project. In a statement, Sudena spokesperson Raymond Zorrilla said the transfers of Chevron and Shell shares underwent strict bidding process and due diligence by all parties involved. He added the share sales were above board and legal. Zorrilla also said the issue of the Malampaya deal has been highly politicized. Dennis Uy Zudena purchased Chevron's 45% share in Malampaya for $565 million and Shell's 45% stake for $460 million. Uy and Energy Secretary Alfonso Pusti are facing a graft complaint over the deal. Complainants said the alleged anomalies in the deal cost government billions of pesos.